And so they want to be facing the east when the Lord comes out of heaven on a cloud. And by the way, the Lord has to come. He's got to be a 33-year-old Jewish male riding on a cumulus cloud out of heaven. That's the modern concept of the parousia, the coming of the Lord, and resurrection, so that that biological body in the grave has to be reconstituted and raised out to see Jesus coming from the east. Yes, John, these preconceived ideas. John, something that is absolutely teetotally amazing to me. Years ago, as I was struggling mightily with my own concepts of resurrection, as I was comparing my concepts and my traditions with what I was seeing from the Bible, is I saw that Paul said over and over that his doctrine of the resurrection was nothing but what was foretold by Moses and the prophets. So I reasoned thusly. If Paul says his doctrine of the resurrection is taken from the Old Testament, then what I need to do is go to the Old Testament and study the doctrine of the resurrection in the Old Testament. Because here I am in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and it dawned on me like the, you know, very subtly, like a load of bricks falling on me from about 1,000 feet high, that Paul said the resurrection would be when Isaiah 25 and Hosea 13 would be fulfilled. My concept was that Paul was talking about the raising of physical bodies out of the grave. Okay, if Paul was predicting the raising of physical bodies out of the grave, and he said that event would be the fulfillment of Isaiah 25 and Hosea 13, then I ought to be able to go to Isaiah 25 and Hosea 13 and find Hosea 13 and Isaiah 25 predicting the resurrection of physical bodies out of the grave. I went back to Isaiah 24 and 25 and Hosea 13. Much to my amazement, I know this is true in your case as well, I discovered that neither Isaiah 24 and 25 or Hosea 13, verse 14, have anything to do with biological resurrection and resuscitation of a physical body out of a hole in the ground. Both passages have to do with the restoration of Israel to a relationship with God, to a covenant relationship with God in the new covenant of Messiah.
Well, here's the point, Don. The problem that we're faced with, and this was one of the final shoes that fell for me on this issue, Don, was that resurrection was an old covenant promise. If the Lord has not returned, then the resurrection is not complete. We've got even more of a problem here, because if the dead have not been raised, then the old covenant, once again, is still in effect.
Every single jot, every single tittle. You know, John, as you know, in public debates that I've had, One of the very favorite questions that I ask my opponents is, are your eschatological hopes, I ask this question of amillennialists and postmillennialists as well. Now, the premillennialists give a different answer. But my amillennial and postmillennial opponents, I have asked this question, are your eschatological hopes based upon a yet future fulfillment of Old Covenant promises made to Old Testament Israel? Invariably, they have said no. I have asked the question, at what point of time and with what event were all, and I've underlined and highlighted, italicized, et cetera, all of God's Old Covenant promises made to Old Covenant Israel fulfilled and his covenant relationship with them terminated? Invariably, my amillennial or postmillennial opponents have said one of two things. Number one, the cross and Pentecost, or A.D. 70. Jesus said, until heaven and earth passes away, not one jot or one tittle shall pass from the law until it is all fulfilled. Paul said the law foretold the resurrection. Acts 24, verse 14. That means that not one iota, not one single iota, that means the animal sacrifices, that means the offering of incense, that means the Levitical priesthood, that means the traveling of, to Jerusalem three times a year, that means every single iota of the Old Covenant Mosaic system, and that means physical circumcision as a command by God, is still binding today if resurrection has not occurred.
You see, that point, Don, is so vital, because many people, obviously, Don, in the dispensational world, believe that resurrection has not occurred, so therefore, if they understood the ramifications of it, they would have to start rethinking this, because we can't be in a new covenant and an old covenant, and it just doesn't work that way. One has to be completed and the other established.
That's exactly right. there was most assuredly a transitional period of time in which the old covenant world was still binding, but it was in the process of passing away. That's what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13, in that he says a new covenant, quoting the promise of Jeremiah 31, 29 to 31, in which God said he was going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. God said that promise of a new covenant meant that in his day, the writer of Hebrews' day, that old covenant was now in the process, nigh unto passing away, is the terminology that he used. It was not yet had not yet passed away, but was about to pass away. And then in chapter 12 of the book of Hebrews, he talks about how God, in the giving of that Mosaic covenant, shook the earth. But he said, yet now once more, I shake not only the earth, but the heavens also. Now this saying, yet once more, signifies the removal of the things that are shaken. Well, what did he say he was going to shake? Heaven and earth. So that the unshakable might remain. Then now notice what he says. Seeing then that we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved. Now what's he saying? He's saying that the world, the heaven and earth that was created by the giving of the law at Sinai, was at that very time that he was writing being shaken, i.e. removed, and they were at that very moment, at that very time, in the process of receiving the unshakable kingdom of God. So they were in this transitional period of time in which the old covenant world of Moses was in the process of passing away. The new covenant world of Christ, the everlasting kingdom, the unshakable kingdom, the unmovable kingdom, was being delivered. What does that mean? Well, let's look at what he says earlier in the chapter. Resurrection would occur, according to Isaiah chapter 25, when God created the Messianic feast on Mount Zion. Resurrection was to be for those who would participate in the Messianic banquet. Isaiah chapter 25. The banquet would be for the resurrected, and it would be on Mount Zion. Isaiah 25, verses 6 and following. Now, folks, the Jews knew of that promise. They longed for that promise. Now, look at what the writer of Hebrews says. That promise of the Messianic banquet for those resurrected from the dead would be when the curse of the covenant, of the old covenant, the veil passed on all the peoples of Isaiah 24, verse 5 and 6, would be removed. In Hebrews chapter 12, the writer says to those who have come into Christ, they know that the old covenant is passing away, and the writer says, you have come to Mount Zion. There could not have been a clearer, more powerful statement that the time for the resurrection had arrived. Doesn't matter what your concept of it is at the moment. If we're going to accept the inspired writer's testimony, he was calling on Isaiah 24 and 25 that said the resurrection would be, the Messianic banquet would be for those raised from the dead when the old covenant that brought the curse and emphasized the curse was removed. And he says to his audience, you have come to Mount Zion. He didn't say, you'll come to Mount Zion in 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years. You have come to Mount Zion. The resurrection was upon them. Well, that means that the new covenant would be given at the time of Israel's salvation, Isaiah chapter 25, verse 9 and 10, but it would also only be made at the time of the resurrection and the Messianic banquet. And again, that would be when the old covenant was removed. For him to say you have come to Mount Zion summed up in one statement all the Messianic salvation hopes of Israel, and it was saying it's on the verge of fulfillment.